Good evening. And tonight we're opening the files on 14 police investigations, and the detectives in charge of those cases here are waiting by the phones in the hope that our viewers tonight can provide the vital new leads they're looking for. The number to ring, as usual, is 01 811 8055.
This month, how a gunman preparing to commit a robbery on a security van was confronted by a keen insurance salesman who tried to sell him an insurance policy. The gunman eventually escaped, without insurance, but with nearly £100,000. The search for three dangerous men who held a couple at gunpoint in their own home in Derbyshire. And a mysterious abduction. A driver who was bundled into the boot of his own car in Runcorn, but escaped while the car was being driven through North Wales.
Our first full reconstruction tonight is the armed hijack of a security van as it made a routine delivery to a bank in Shipley in West Yorkshire. One of the security guards was so badly shaken that he still hasn't been able to return to work. The robbery took place on Wednesday the 5th of July, but the clues that could solve this case might come from viewers who remember seeing two stolen vehicles which had been taken from Essex 2 weeks before that. Before we see the reconstruction, I should point out that the Group 4 security van which was hijacked has since been modified. This robbery wouldn't have been possible on one of the modern vans. Our film begins near Shipley in Bradford towards the end of June. People living in Myers Lane in Bradford noticed two cars they hadn't seen before in the local car park. The most distinctive was a blue top-of-the-range Mitsubishi Shogun. The other was a pale metallic green Ford Granada Scorpio.
It looks like that blue Shogun again, Barbara.
Between the 29th of June and the 5th of July, the two cars came and went nearly every day. Each evening they returned to the car park. But the question is, where did they go during the daytime? Few of the residents actually saw the cars arrive or leave, and it seems whoever was using them was making an early start to the day's activities. At about 7 o'clock in the morning on Friday the 30th of June, at a school just down the road from the car park, van driver Ken Cowell had just finished delivering the children's lunches for that day. At the junction with the main road, Ken had to brake sharply. Ken remembers the driver was a blonde, rather attractive woman. Where was she going in such a hurry so early in the morning? July the 5th, the day of the robbery. It's a quiet Wednesday morning at the shopping centre in Shipley. As lunchtime approaches, staff at this branch of the TSB bank are expecting a routine delivery by Group 4 security. It's now 12:30. A few streets away, Derek Thornton, an insurance salesman, is making notes on the results of his morning's appointments.
I was parked at the side of the road, filling some insurance paperwork out, as the blue Shogun drove past me. Shunted about a little bit, parked up behind me. I was watching him do all this while still doing the paperwork. I did actually get out and have a few words with the guy.
Am I all right parked here?
Yeah, it's a nice car you've got.
Yeah, not bad, is it?
Why are you a builder?
Yeah, that's right.
I've got just the thing that
will
interest
you. Look, I'm in a bit of a hurry at the moment. I'll talk to you when I get back.
OK.
By 1:30, the town centre is busy with lunchtime shoppers. Next door to the bank is Thomas Duggan House, a small block of offices. The robber used the foyer there to wait and watch while the delivery took place. Screened as they were by the van, no one nearby saw what was happening.
Now you, drive. Switch that off or I'll shoot him. Now drive.
Where are we going?
Just shut up and I'll tell you where to go. Left at the bottom.
To get to the main road, they could have taken either of two turnings.
Then right here. First right, first right.
They actually took the longer route, and police believe the robber had done some research, because while the other road is shorter, it's also narrower, and they'd have run the risk of having to stop if something came the other way.
Straight over there. Come on, move it.
After crossing the busy commercial street, they took Victoria Street over the Leeds and Liverpool Canal towards Jerome's Mill.
Right, now put your foot down.
Turning into Ives Street, they headed for the side of the building where the Shogun had been left an hour earlier.
Pulling left at the bottom. In there. Okay, you, out. Come on, move it. Now get your mate to send the money out.
Barry, throw the money out.
Quickly, come on.
Come on, Barry.
This access to the cash is impossible with the modern Group 4 vans.
Faster!
That's all there is.
Come on, I know there's more. You're going to Keithley next. Now move!
Fast, come on, he knows! Barry, come on!
Quickly now! Right, now you! Put the money in the back of the car. Come on, let's go! Move it! Go on! Put it in there! Right, now lie down on the floor.
What are you going to do?
You'll be all right.
A motorist saw the man taking off his mask just before turning into Otley Road. After half a mile, he turned into Cliff Lane towards Baildon Wood Court. Police believe there was an accomplice waiting in the Scorpio, but they've not yet had a positive description. Did you see anyone there that afternoon? From Cliff Lane, the Scorpio must have gone back to Otley Road and then on to the town of Guiseley, about 4.5 miles north of Shipley. The trail ends in the car park of the Guiseley and District Factory Workers Club. Across the road is The Drop, a popular local pub. But it was 2 weeks before the abandoned car was reported to the police. Well, Detective Inspector Chris Wilson is in charge of this case. Now, as I said at the start of the film, the important clues in this case might come from viewers who saw either of those two distinctive cars in the last week in June or the first week in July. Where exactly, to start with, were those cars stolen from?
Well, the Mitsubishi Shogun was stolen on the evening or the night of the 20th of June, Tuesday 20th of June, at a garage in Boreham near Chelmsford in Essex, Osborne's garage. This vehicle appeared at Myers Lane about Sunday the 25th of June. The Scorpio, Granada Scorpio, was stolen on the night of Tuesday the 27th of June from a garage called Quest Motors in Braintree in Essex. And again, this vehicle appeared in Bradford within 1 or 2 days. So two vehicles stolen from Essex, both appearing in Bradford before or by the 29th of June.
So where was the Shogun, do you think, in the 5 days between it being stolen in Essex and turning up in Bradford?
Well, that's what I'm trying to find out. We obviously, it's been parked somewhere, it's been hidden somewhere, or it's been moved somewhere.
It's surprising, do you think, that the number plates weren't changed, especially as the Shogun is such a distinctive car?
Well, both the Shogun and the Granada Scorpio are distinctive cars. Both vehicles, while they were parked in Myers Lane and also on the day of the robbery, were still bearing their original registration plates.
Now, when those cars drove out of Myers Lane car park every day, where were they going, do you think?
Well, as far as the Shogun's concerned, We have several sightings of the Shogun down in Ive Street in Shipley, where the transfer of the money from the security van took place. The vehicle has obviously been used to rehearse the planned robbery. They came back each night and parked up in Myers Lane at night time. My question will be, the people who were using those vehicles during the day, where were they staying during each night?
So they were in Bradford for over a week, planning that robbery every single day?
I am quite satisfied this robbery is well and truly planned, using the vehicles during the daytime, parking it up at night time. The question again is, where were the people staying at night time?
Now, several people saw the man, didn't they? Our video fit is apparently a very good likeness, so could we have the description of him?
The description of the man involved in this incident is a man between 30 and 40 years of age. He's 5'8" to 5'10" tall, medium build. Some people have described him as muscular. He's got dark brown hair. Some people call him quite good looking, and at the time of the robbery was wearing a blue body warmer.
Right, so we're looking for that man and possibly his blonde associate too.
Yes, we're quite satisfied that he has a blonde female associate. There's also a possibility he could have someone other helping him in this inquiry.
Right, well, there's a £10,000 reward in this case. So if you did see the man or his blonde associate or either of those two vehicles, or if there's anything you can add, please ring us here in the studio on 01811 8055. That's 01811 8055. Other members of Detective Inspector Wilson's team are standing by at the Shipley Incident Room, and the number there is 0274 373 444. That's 0274, the code for Shipley, 373 444.
In fact, one of last month's reconstructions prompted more calls to Crimewatch than any in this programme's history. It was about the murder of Peter and Gwenda Dixon, two holidaymakers who were ambushed as they hiked along a clifftop path in southwest Wales. First, there's a strong lead on a blonde man seen with a prime suspect near the post office at Marlowe's. A Crimewatch viewer told us he'd given a lift to a German student of this description who'd been hitchhiking on the M4. On Wednesday, the 21st of June, he dropped him off at Kilgetty. Now, the student told him he was hoping to walk along the Pembrokeshire coastal path to Fishguard, then go to Ireland and from there to Scotland, eventually returning home to Germany via Dover sometime in August. He was planning to stay in youth hostels, so please call us if you think you also met that student or might know who he is, because he might quite innocently hold the key to this murder. He was 18 or 19, about 5'8" or 5'9". He was carrying a rucksack and he spoke pretty good English. There were other important calls too on that case. Two men who'd been seen on a stile near the scene of the killings have since been eliminated from the inquiry. And two fishermen called to say that they overheard a radio conversation which could well have involved Mr. Dixon. If you remember, he was an amateur radio enthusiast. He was talking to someone called Tom, or possibly John, who was in a boat fishing off the Pembrokeshire coast. If that someone was you, please call us straight away. Remember, this is a murder inquiry. The number is 01811 8055.
Well, there's rather less news so far, I'm afraid, on our other reconstructions from last month, but we were looking for a man who used the name of Mr. A. Winner. You might remember that case, if only for the dreadful pun from David Hatcher, who hoped the man would become a loser. The man was wanted in connection with a deception inquiry. Well, six Crimewatch viewers called with the same name, a real name, and inquiries switched from London to Plymouth and then to Swansea. A man has now been arrested.
Well, out of this month's photo call, where once again police hope you might recognise pictures of people they'd like to put some questions to. Here's Superintendent David Hatcher.
First, Gloucestershire Police would like to speak to Daniel Michael Gardner. He may have information about the murder of Alan Robert White, who was last seen alive on the 18th of February in Minchin Hampton. His body was recovered from a lake at the Cotswold Water Park in Somerford Keynes on the 27th of May. Daniel Gardner is 29 years old, 6 feet tall, with blue eyes and tattoos on both arms. He may have changed his hair now and shaved off his moustache, so if you think you know where he is, please call us now. Next, we need your help to find this man. On Sunday, the 26th of March, together with an accomplice, he robbed a thresher off licence on Green Lane in Morden, South London. He tried to force the manager to open the safe, but when it couldn't be opened, they made off with cash from the till and some cigarettes. The man without the balaclava is about 40, 5'10" tall and heavily built. If that's a familiar face to you, please get in touch. West Mercia Police would like to talk to Christopher John Carswell, who may have information about a number of companies set up from May of this year. Goods and services amounting to £250,000 were obtained by the companies through false references. Christopher Carswell is in his early 20s, 5'8" and of stocky build. He's from the West Midlands area, but might now be in London or on the South Coast. If you recognise him, please let us know. And lastly, officers from Skegness in Lincolnshire want to speak to David Andrew Pleasance. He may be able to help us solve a number of serious burglaries, including one at a garage in Mablethorpe, Lincolnshire. He might be using a red XR3i Ford Escort, registration number C289LVL. Now, that was stolen from Cleethorpes on the 9th of September. Pleasance is 30 years old, 5'9", with short, dark brown hair, and he's a Keep Fit fanatic. If you know where he is, don't approach him. Just call us if you recognise him or any of our other photo call faces.
And if there is somebody there you think you recognise, the number to ring here in the studio is 01 811 8055. That's 01 811 8055.
Our next case takes us to a village near Matlock in Derbyshire. In the early evening of Friday, June the 23rd, there was a robbery at the village of Cromford. Now, we often say on Crime Watch, violent crime is rarer than many people fear, and indeed it is. But this turned out to be one of those unusual but particularly distressing cases where people are actually attacked in their own homes. Because of the nature of the incident, we've not tried to reenact what happened. Instead, Helen Phelps describes the search for clues.
Cromford lies on the edge of the Derbyshire Peak District. It's a pretty village near the market town of Matlock. John Dunn has lived in the area all his life. He runs a haulage company which is based in a quarry near Wirksworth. When he started his business, he had one lorry. He now has a fleet of 10 and employs 20 people. John is well known in Cromford and is considered to be a good employer. Just over a year ago, he built a snooker room behind his house for his employees and friends.
Right, lads, we're going out tonight, so make yourselves at home.
Although we've used actors, John Dunn and Marie Nash will tell their own story in their own words.
It was my granddaughter's third birthday, and we were going up to her house with some presents and cards we'd got. And I got ready, and John was in the process of getting ready. I was watching the television. I come down and watched Toby's frame game. John was upstairs getting ready, and so I decided to go up and take the washing up. While I was going up the stairs, I happened to look through the side window, and I saw the outline of a car.
John? Some cheeky bugger's parked in our parking spot.
Just so look, a man got out. Then he was joined by another man with long hair.
They're coming to the door. You'd better come down. It's probably for you.
The doorbell rang, and I just went back the two stairs and opened the door.
Inside. Move.
Sort of pushed me and said, get down and don't look up at me.
Do as we say and you won't get hurt.
I just could not breathe. I just couldn't get a breath. I was all out of breath. And he said, you're all right. Just want the million. He says, when we've got the million, we'll go and leave you. So you're not going to get hurt once we get the million.
Tell me where it is.
You've got that sort of money. I don't know where you...
John was still upstairs, unaware of what was happening to Marie.
Where is it? Where'd you keep it?
I was in the bedroom getting changed. And I heard something coming upstairs, all rattling. I went to the bedroom door to see what was going off, and I was just confronted with two men with guns.
Where is it? We've come for the million.
I tried to take one gun away. The other one was on my back, and I was straight down on the floor and handcuffed. And
you know,
I could hear everything being thrown about. They'd been everywhere except where the money was.
Keep still.
But when he got the money, he pulled it out. He just said, that's not money, it's shit.
We want the million!
Where's the money?
What's a million? You never found a million here.
First he did say, is your name John? He said, I own the quarry, I don't own a quarry. He said, I'd got a big safe, I hadn't got a big safe.
Just after 7:40, a friend went past to play snooker. He noticed the maroon Cavalier on the drive, but didn't think it too strange because cars often park there.
They threatened me, they put a gun in my mouth, pulled the ammo back, hit me with a cosh thing.
The intruder stole a shotgun, cash, and John's collection of old coins and silver watches. The robbers came up fast behind a motorist on Market Place as they made their getaway towards the A6. Amazed at their manoeuvre, he chased after them. They travelled 3 miles along the A6, but when the Cavalier turned into the Holmesford Cottage pub car park, the witness decided to drive on. Were you in that car park just after 8 o'clock on Friday the 23rd of June? Perhaps you saw three men running away from a maroon Vauxhall.
Twice in the week before the robbery, an identical car was seen here at this car park. Could it have been the robbers practicing their getaway? The woman who saw the car thinks that a white van was with it. The Vauxhall Cavalier was stolen off a garage forecourt in Runcorn on June the 9th. Just 2 weeks before the robbery. In that time, it clocked up 240 miles, far more than the distance between Runcorn and Cromford. So where had it been? The trail may lead to Liverpool. The false plates were made up at two different garages in the Merseyside area.
Despite weeks of investigation, the police are still no closer to finding the robbers.
I did say to Mary after it happened,
I'll move, didn't you?
Like, should we flit? Should we move? And she says, no, they're not putting me off.
Mick Bolton, where on earth did the robbers get the idea from that John and Mary Dunn had that sort of money, £1 million?
I don't know, but they were very, very wrong.
They used a tremendous amount of violence. Obviously, we didn't show any of it, but there was a lot.
Appalling violence was used. And according to Mr. Dunn, he feels that were it not for the intervention of one of the men, the other two would have killed both him and Mrs. Nash.
Really? They made a homemade cosh. I mean, the nastiness, the premeditation of that weapon.
Yes.
Tell us what we know about the men, what descriptions we have.
Three white men, aged 20, 25 and 29 years. They'd got long hair. One of them is described as having a Welsh or Irish accent. The other one with a Merseyside, Liverpool accent. The noticeable feature about one of the men was that he was wearing a black baseball cap with the word Olympic written across the front of it.
There's a reward, isn't there?
Yes, £7,000.
OK, now, that red Cavalier, we know it was stolen on the 9th of June. The attack was on the 23rd of June.
Right.
It had plates on it. These are the false plates here, F699ATJ. Badly want to know where that vehicle was. Possibly wasn't the Liverpool area, because that's where the plates came from.
That's correct.
And what about that white van? Was that part of the robbery, do you think, or was that an innocent person just happened to be at the same place?
Well, it was seen twice that week, the week of the robbery, in the Cromford area. If it is owned by a local person, then I'd like them to contact me.
OK. They stole cash, as we saw. They also stole a distinctive 12-bore shotgun.
That's right. It was a Browning 5-shot repeater. One of the men was particularly interested in this weapon. In fact, he took it to pieces, asked Mr. Dunn how it worked, very interested in it, and having done all this, he asked Mr. Dunn if he could have it.
God knows what damage they're going to do with that. We saw the five or six pocket watches that were stolen in a linen bank bag, I think.
Yes, that's right.
Now these, this is an Amstrad computer. This is a Mobira Cityman 1320 transport. Now, if you've been offered a phone like this, which has been given to you with all the car kit, for car fitting, but which has not got any of the mains charger stuff with it, particularly if you've been offered it with an Amstrad PC 1640 20 megabyte hard disk computer, they were stolen from the red vehicle.
They were.
So, let us know if you've heard of those, or of anything else to do with this case. 01811 8055 is the number, or you can call the incident room in Buxton Police Station. That's on 02987210. That's 02987210, the code for Buxton, 72100.
Well, we're already receiving calls on the hijack of the Group 4 security van. We've received information from a number of people who think they've identified the blonde woman who drove the Mitsubishi Shogun, and one caller thinks that the video fit may be a man from Essex. We're also receiving some calls already on the Dixon case, so we'll hope for some more information later. On last month's programme, we appealed for calls on a man who might have information about a series of alleged crimes committed against elderly people in Scotland. And as a direct result, a man has now been arrested and charged with culpable homicide and a substantial number of cases of theft, fraud and assault.
And a man has pleaded guilty after Crimewatch viewers recognised him on photocall and called in with his address. 3.5 hours after the programme, the police ended a 5-year hunt for him when they raided a house near Manchester. The man was charged with deception and handling stolen cheques. And at his trial, he asked for a total of 1,090 offences to be taken into consideration. He was jailed for 2.5 years.
Well, now with Incident Desk, here once again is Superintendent David Hatcher.
First, a case of attempted murder of a 54-year-old woman in Croydon, Surrey. At about 3:45 p.m. on Monday the 19th of June, Mrs. Sukram Osman returned home to find three men had broken into her house. Although she told them she didn't have any valuables, they still beat her up and shot her with an air pistol, blinding her in one eye. When they left, they took with them a small amount of cash and 2-gallon-sized bottles of Bell's whiskey. Now, each bottle is nearly 2 feet tall and can only be sold to pubs, clubs and restaurants. So, if you've been offered one of these distinctive bottles, please get in touch. The attackers made their getaway in a gold or bronze Ford Capri or Opel Manta. It had front spoilers and skirts. Two of the attackers are between 18 and 25 years old, slim build and of mixed race. One of them has a moustache. We know less about the third attacker, except that he is also slim build and of mixed race. We're anxious to find these men before they strike again, so if you can help, please let us know. Next, we need to find another extremely dangerous man who attacked an old lady of 74 in Winnersh, Berkshire. At about 10:45 a.m. on Friday the 21st of July, he tricked his way into the woman's home and raped her at knife point. Afterwards, he pushed her into a cupboard, placing heavy furniture in front of it. But luckily, she managed to escape and raise the alarm. The attacker is between 35 and 40 years of age, 5'10" to 6 feet tall, of heavy build, and had receding gingery hair. He may have made his getaway in a pale blue car. If you recognise him, then please call us now. Finally, if you recognise this lorry, you could help us trace a thief whose vandalism led to a woman's death. It's a blue Foden articulated lorry and trailer. It has the logo of ECC Buildings Products on the cab, and its registration number is PEU288Y. Now, it was stolen while parked overnight on Tuesday the 5th of September from the Kewstoke Road quarry in Weston-super-Mare. Other lorries parked here had their wheel nuts tampered with, and the next day one of these lorries lost 2 wheels while travelling on the M5. One wheel hit a lorry travelling in the opposite direction. That lorry jumped the crash barrier and crushed a car, killing the driver. Now, we've little doubt that the theft of the articulated lorry and the attempted theft of the lorry wheels are linked. So, if you think you've seen this lorry since the 5th of September, call us now.
Well, here's the telephone number once again. If you can help in any way, it's 01811 8055. 01811 8055.
On the case of the robbery on the Thresher off licence in Maudlin in South London, we've got some interesting information coming in on that with a possible identification. On the Dixon murder, callers have requested that we clarify the channel on which Mr. Dixon was transmitting. I can tell you it was channel 33. So if you were in that boat and you were calling someone who might have been Mr. Dixon, particularly if your name was Tom or John, please call us, 01811 8055. Now, our next reenactment is of a crime that's not only unusual, but baffling in several ways. It's the abduction of a businessman for no obvious motive. The victim was Alan Frew. He's an executive for a large, respected company. Given his ordeal, we naturally didn't ask him to go through it all again. So in our reconstruction, an actor plays his part and reads extracts from Mr. Frew's statement to the police. Our film begins in Llandudno about 4 weeks ago. It's late in the afternoon of Monday, September the 11th.
Please, I've just been kidnapped in Runcorn by two people. They've left me off in Llandudno.
Thanks. Mr. Frew, I can see that you're badly shaken, but I'm sure that you can appreciate how vital it is that we get to the bottom of this as soon as possible.
Of course.
Now, I want you to try and relax. Think hard and tell us exactly what's gone on today from start to finish. Can you try and do that for us?
Yes. I left my office in Runcorn between 12:15 and 12:30.
Alan Frew had taken his company Jaguar XJ6 to go to the bank in Runcorn Old Town. It was almost lunchtime, and he then decided to take a break from his routine, which would normally mean eating in the company restaurant. Instead, he drove 4 miles into the countryside.
Hello.
Yes, please.
Could I have a piece of fish, please?
Yeah.
How much is that?
£80, please.
He headed for a quiet spot just off the A56, 2 miles outside Frodsham, and settled down to eat his fish and listen to the lunchtime news on Radio 4.
And this is Robin Lustig in London. The news today is dominated by the extraordinary human tide of refugees from East Germany. The number to have reached the West since midnight is already put at around 5,000.
It seems that sometime in the next hour or so, he fell asleep. At about 3 p.m, a gardener saw two men on a motorbike as he worked at Barrow Lane near Foxhill Farm.
This is the gun! Do as you're told or you're dead! Get out of the car! I'll get the boot open.
There's a button underneath.
Get in.
The car drove off at speed. Cramped and rolling as the car took winding roads, Alan soon became disoriented.
Are you all right in there?
Yes.
We're just going for a little drive. We'll drop you off in about 10 minutes.
I became aware of the distinctive engine noise of a trial's motorcycle, which was obviously keeping close to the car. I guessed that I would be robbed at some point, and so hid a wallet containing my credit cards and a sum of money totaling 250 or 260 pounds behind the spare wheel. I kept one note of 10 or 20 pounds, since I did not think it would be credible to have no money on me at all.
Give us your money. You must have more than this on you.
Are you all right? Do you want to take your jacket off?
No.
Turn away. Do that again and you're dead.
What the hell do you want with me?
We're going to let you off in a few minutes.
Look, the atmosphere in here is killing me. Why don't you let me out? I'll give you 30 minutes before I tell anyone about this.
Give us 30 minutes, would you? Because the only other way would be to tie you up and gag you. And you wouldn't like that, would you?
Some 60 miles away in Colwyn Bay, the Jaguar was noticed by two accountants who were working in their office.
Hey, that's peculiar.
What is?
The way that lad got in the Jag.
They didn't think the men in jeans and trainers seemed the type to own a nearly new Jaguar. Meanwhile, above the loud music, Alan made out two voices and heard the electric windows and sunroof being played with. The motorbike had now disappeared.
Eventually, the lights were operated, but not fully switched off, since the interior boot light was left on. This allowed me to make out the screw fittings which secured the boot lock, and I was able to use a screwdriver obtained from the toolkit, which was located in the boot, to unfasten the screws.
But when the boot opens in an XJ6, a warning light flashes on the dashboard.
Can't say what he's on that foot!
Get back in there!
No, I'm having it! Oh, leave it,
for Christ's sake, leave it. We've got to get rid of the stuff. Oh, oh. The Jaguar was seen nearby at Llandudno Junction at about 5:15 p.m. A witness watched as it drove into the entrance of a disused warehouse. The two men ran off in the direction of Conway Castle.
Jim Buckley, what on earth were those men after? They didn't do all that for a joyride, presumably.
No, it's a strange case. We don't think that we've established a true motive. Although a robbery was committed in the stealing of the £20, we don't think we've got the true answers to what they intended to do with Mr. Frew. They obviously intended to keep hold of him.
What about descriptions of the men? I know we've managed to establish a Crimewatch video fit for one of them.
We have. This is the first offender. He's described as a white male, 20 to 25 years, 5 feet 10 to 6 feet tall. He's described as well-built, and he was wearing a blue denim suit and a white T-shirt with a collar. He also wore sunglasses and a dark crash helmet with distinctive orange or red flashes on the sides. His hair is very blonde, as you can see, and is spiky on top and has been described as similar to the Bros Pop group.
Now, we haven't got a video fit of the second one, but we've got some ideas what he's like.
Oh, he again is a white male, 20 to 25 years, 5 foot 10 to 6 feet tall, although slightly smaller than number one. He's described as fairly well built with short, straight, mid-brown hair. And he again wore denim jeans and a casual jacket similar to an anorak.
Now, Mr. Frew thought it was a trials bike, he heard. You're pretty clear it was a trail bike. The distinction is a trail bike you can get two people on, you can get a pillion passenger on. So presumably these two guys who did the hijack came on the bike as seen by the chap working nearby.
Yes, they were seen by a witness, and it is a dual-seated bike described as a trail bike.
Now, you want to find, obviously, anybody who saw that trail bike with the E-Reg Jag, blue Jaguar, XJ6. What was the road? It's presumably the A55, is it, that coastal road?
It is indeed. I'm anxious to trace, first of all, the two men seen on the motorcycle prior to the abduction. I'm anxious also to trace people who may well have seen the motorcycle and the Jaguar in convoy. And I'm also anxious to trace people who may have seen the two youths in the Jaguar car on the A55 towards Llandudno.
Also, if you saw those two men escaping at Llandudno Junction, they were seen possibly by a chief inspector as they ran away towards Conway Castle there. If you could have seen those two men after they left the Jaguar, please do call us. Here's the number, straight here to the studio. That's 01-811-8055. If you prefer, you can call Cheshire Police Headquarters on 0244-313131. That's 0244, the code for Chester, 313131.
And now a second file of people whom police would very much like to interview. With photocall once again, here's Superintendent David Hatcher.
First, we need to trace this man who's robbed three Leeds permanent building societies in London over the past 2 months. The first was on the 21st of August at the Edgware Road branch when he threatened staff with a black automatic handgun and got away with £1,200. Then on the 4th of September, he went into the Kilburn branch brandishing a single-barrelled sawn-off shotgun. He fled empty-handed when staff refused to hand over any money. And on the 15th of September, he robbed the Wembley branch of over £2,000 after threatening staff with a black automatic handgun. We think he may have robbed other building societies in the London area. He's described as being about 25 years old, 6 feet tall, and of slim build, with short, light brown hair. And he has a large nose. Each time he wears a stocking mask. If you recognise him, please let us know. Next, we'd like your help to find Paul Anthony Collier. We think he might have information about a series of deceptions totalling £180,000. A counterfeit cheque like this one has been used to buy 5 cars. The cheque number and the account number are both false. Paul Collier is 29, 6 feet tall, slim build with mousy hair. You may know him as Paul Cameron or William Mooney. If you've seen him, call us now. And my colleagues from Thames Valley would like to speak to this man. On Friday the 8th of September, at about 10 a.m, he went into a building society in Oxford armed with a black revolver. He ordered the cashiers to fill a co-op carrier bag with cash and then made his getaway on foot. He's described as in his early 20s, 5'8" tall and slim build. He was wearing a dark woolen hat, but we think his hair is brown. If you recognise him, then please phone us now. There is a reward for his arrest and conviction. And lastly, police in Leeds are trying to trace Ian Thomas Russell. He may have information regarding company chequebooks which were stolen. Cheques amounting to nearly £60,000 were fraudulently written and deposited into 2 bank accounts. Ian Russell was last seen on the 14th of September at the Leeds Permanent Building Society in Dover. And we think he may be driving a white BMW 325i similar to this one. Its registration number, E802CWC. Ian Russell is about 30 years old, 5'8" tall, with green eyes. If you've seen him or any of our other photo call faces, please call us straight away.
Here's the number if you think you can help, 01-811-8055. That's 01-811-8055.
A call still coming in on all our cases, but particularly on the Shogun and Scorpio robbery, the hijack of the security van. There have been possible sightings of the Shogun in Keighley and in Halifax. Police are particularly interested in a reported sighting of the Shogun in Bradford as well. We've had a few calls on sightings before the 20th of June, but we need it after the 20th of June, between 20th of June and the 5th of July. And a couple of callers believe they saw the German hitchhiker involved, who the police are looking for in connection with the Dixon's murder in Southern Ireland, so we'll follow that up too. Calls still coming in, of course, to the studio on 01-811-8055. And if you've been dialing that number and haven't got through yet, please do keep trying. There are 20 lines here and they're open until midnight. You'll find the relevant police numbers on CFAX, if you have that, on page 186. Or you can write to us at Crimewatch UK, BBC Television, London W12 7RJ. We're back after question time with any news in Crimewatch Update at 11:45.
And if that's beyond your bedtime, let me say, as always, you're much less likely to encounter major crime than the volume of appeals and reconstructions on Crimewatch sometimes makes it seem. And in any case, rest assured that with the calls coming in right now, some of those cases are being solved. So don't have nightmares, do please. Sleep well. Good night.
Good night.
Walk up to another crime scene.